So thanks for making the time to come out on such a beautiful evening in Hobart. It really shows the interest in this type of conversation, which is really pleasing. So welcome to our public event, and happy Agriculture Day for those that weren't aware. I hope everybody got a drink on the way in, and I just want to remind everybody that we'll be having more drinks and nibbles after this event. So please hang around for that if you can make the time. First of all, my name is James Tronick. I'm the Deputy Director of Strategy and Engagement for TEA. And I'm your MC this evening, so I'm going to help guide you through this process. So my first honour is to introduce Rob Anders. So Rob is a technical officer with the university, with the spatial sciences component of the School of Land and Food. But more importantly for us and relevant for this evening, he plays a role of an ambassador in building relationships for the university with the Indigenous community. He's going to take us through a welcome to country ceremony and description. So Rob, thank you for joining us this evening, and I'm looking forward to what happens next.
Thank you, and it's a pleasure. So as I begin, I'm going to pass around two abalone shells with some powdered ochre. And I'll just ask that as it comes around, that you just sort of touch up with your fingers, just sort of rub a little bit on your fingers so that you've got it there. And being a sort of different pigment, it should wash out, but obviously if you're wearing a lovely black dress or something like that, then it might sort of go everywhere. That's right. So I'm Rob Anders. I'm a direct descendant of my ancestral grandfather Manawagena and his daughter Wurrimodiana. My people are the Trawlway people from Tebrakuna country up in the far northeast of Tasmania. In the absence of any people from this country, I acknowledge that the land we gather on tonight is the clan country of the Mutanenana people of the Southeast Nation. I pay my respects to their elders, past, present, and those who may be there but are coming up in the future. I acknowledge and pay my respects to other Aboriginal people who may be in the audience with us tonight. I also want to acknowledge that a great war took place on this land, which unfortunately saw the death and suffering of the Tasmanian Aboriginal people. The country of the Mutanenana people is dominated by an almighty mountain that we see up there, and a great river system that flows all the way down to the sea up into the central highlands of Tasmania. Both of those features are known by many names by many people. Warrini, a great storyteller from the Southeast people, knew of this land as Lutruwita. My ancestral grandfather, Manawagena, who most of Tasmania's Aboriginal people descend from, knew this land as Tawana. Manawagena said that the land was created by two ancestral beings, Pombahau and Pinatunur, who travelled across the Milky Way at the beginning of time. They are said to have built the mountains, valleys and rivers and made plants and animals and people out of the ground. Tasmanian Aboriginal people have lived through and survived an ice age, a time when sea level fell some 120 metres and rose to the present day level, during which Tasmania became separated from that great land mass to the north some 10,000 years ago. Tasmanian Aboriginal people are the traditional owners and custodians of this land, who carefully and sustainably have farmed manage these lands and borders for some 40 to 60,000 years so far. At this point though, I'd like you to think about the significance of the ochre as it is handed around. For Aboriginal people, ochre is country. To wear ochre is to wear country and is something to be proud of, as we are part of this country. But sharing ochre this evening comes with a message. The sacred ochre that you touch represents soil. Soil is the giver of life, which we all depend upon. Since colonisation, farming practices have changed on unprecedented scales. They include the clearing of land and the drainage of wetlands and marshes, to the introduction of chemicals and water through dams and irrigators. As stakeholders and participants in agriculture, there are challenges and responsibilities. Like other cultures, food and the sharing of food is central in our culture. There are the challenges that are faced, that are coming up, to explore and develop new markets and opportunities, demands for a growing world population, and of course, the underlying economic gain. However, rub your fingers with the ochre on it to remind yourself again of the precious soil and our connection to country. As land managers, the responsibility is to ensure that our country is cared for and looked after. Aboriginal people sustainably managed this land for some 40,000 to 60,000 years or so. The question that is in my mind is how this will look into the future. Thank you. I wish that this evening will have community discussions and celebrations.
Thanks, Rob, and thanks so much for also your thoughtful representation and connection from Aboriginal culture into the topic of conversation today, which is agriculture. So it's much appreciated. I should also just note that Rob's an alumni of the university, or graduate of the university, has a Bachelor of Surveying with honours, and has been with the School of Land and Food since 1992, so a long time, playing a very important role with us. And we've had some really positive discussions this year, and we think that we can formally recognise that ambassadorial role within the university. So I think we're very close to having achieved that, which I think will be a really good step forward for the university. So to provide those with some in the audience with a bit of context, so this National Agriculture Day is hosted by the Tasmanian Institute of Agriculture, TIA. TIA was established in 1996 as a Centre of Excellence for Agricultural Research, Development and Extension in Tasmania. It's a joint venture between the Tasmanian Government and the University of Tasmania. TIA conducts internationally relevant agricultural research, development and extension with direct benefits for Tasmania. Our research priorities range from dairy, grains and grazing to annual and perennial horticulture, food safety and agricultural systems. This wide range of R&D contributes towards a more profitable, productive and sustainable agricultural sector. The current total value of TIA's research portfolio was approximately $70 million. So that demonstrates the complexity and also the effort and investment that an organisation like TIA can attract to Tasmania to generate that value for Tasmania. In an academic sense, TIA as an agricultural university is ranked 44th in the world, and this is no small achievement for a relatively small university in the worldwide stage. We're also ranked 4th in Australia, again, a pretty good achievement for a university based in Tasmania. So this is a reflection of the capable researchers and talent that we have within our teams, but also their hard work and their focus and connection to the industry. So when we talk to some of the global companies that we talk to, the standout feature for their conversations with TIA is that it is genuinely community and industry focused relative to a lot of the institutions that they deal with. So it's a competitive advantage for us and something that we're proud of. But it's also something that's real. And tonight's event is an example of that. So last week we hosted our open day at the Forthside Vegetable Centre. Some of you were there for that event. And this is an important event to promote communication between the research that we're doing within TEP and its community. At the Open Day, the Minister for Primary Industries and Water, the Honourable Jeremy Rockliffe, launched the White Paper, Growing Tasmania's Agricultural Research Development and Extension for 2050, a piece of work that we've been closely working with DePickley, and also with the community, as they've given us feedback about what they are looking for RD&E in Tasmania, for which TEP is obviously a strong part. So this paper outlines the government's future direction for agriculture and RD&E in Tasmania, and also the roles and how it expects TEP to play that role. So where do TEP want to create value for Tasmanian food producers and processors, as well as inform policy discussion with industry and government? TEP has a valuable opportunity to help find the future direction of RD&E, the Tasmanian agricultural and food sector. So to help contextualise this role, I'm very pleased to launch this event tonight and to launch this project publicly. So TEP's Aspirations for Food and Agriculture project. I'd just like to add one thing before we play the video clip. So Pete Leith and I had a conversation about this some time ago, and I have been working with TEP for about 3 years now. I've been listening to a lot of people describe what they see as some of the barriers to producers, growers in Tasmania, and everybody has their view. Of course, everybody has their view, and that view's right, but they're all different. So the conversation I've been having with Pete was bringing some of those tensions and some of those differences of opinion into an academic sense, and Pete, to his credit, took this on as a great academic challenge. And for me, this is the role that the university can play within its community to genuinely and deeply and academically, robustly understand what is happening in its environment that might be a barrier to its aspirations or might better articulate its aspirations. With this knowledge, it helps TEP and the university and other stakeholders in this environment make active decisions around what type of interventions might be required to achieve the future directions that we can all buy into. So it's a really important piece of work for me. It's an important piece of work, I know, for Pete, but it is underpinned by strong and deep academic capability and thought. So it's a relevant role for the university to play in this environment. So I'm very excited. Personally excited about this project. So, go clear.
How can we support Tasmania's agricultural sector to be vibrant, productive and sustainable in the 21st century? The Aspirations for Food and Agriculture project is a new initiative of the Tasmanian Institute of Agriculture, TIA. The project will help TIA define its future direction for research, development and engagement. It will help us meet the needs of the agriculture and food sector, support sustainable growth and ensure the sector is competitive into the future. At TIA, we believe the best way to achieve this is by listening to the diverse voices of people working in the sector. There are many diverse views about future solutions. This project will reveal actual needs with academic rigour. The Aspirations for Food and Agriculture project is engaging with food processors and producers, including 100 in-depth conversations at kitchen tables and boardrooms across the state. We want to hear diverse perspectives about the barriers to agricultural success and your ideas for a way forward. We want to explore the many ways that you are already navigating the changing agricultural environment. We also want to engage the community in a broader discussion about food and agriculture, where we are going and how we're going to get there. In 2018, the Aspirations for Food and Agriculture project will reach out to food producers and processors across the state. You will have the opportunity to help shape the way we at TIA do research, development and engagement into the future. For more information about the Aspirations for Food and Agriculture project, visit the TIA website.
Thanks, Claire. So there's a problem with that video. And the problem is that it looks like we have this production team sitting within TIA and enormous resources at our disposal. The reality is we have one very talented but very pregnant communications officer who's done an awesome job of just pulling together a really professional group. So thanks to Phoebe Bobby for pulling that together. We've allowed the 2 weeks maternity leave. But she's genuinely excellent. Right, so I'd just like to invite our panel to move to, I assume, the red seats, the hot seats. And I'll just work through an introduction. So I'm really excited by our first panelist, Dr. Michelle Filipov. And I assume that Michelle's going to be in charge of bringing some anarchy to this discussion. So Michelle's research has always drawn her to exploring the extremes. She's an expert in media and communications and has applied these skills to food and death metal. She explores how the media is shaping our relationship with food and in particular what this means for food producers. The rise of boutique food and celebrity chef TV shows are an example of our change of behaviour in relation to food. They're influencing what we eat, how we eat, and how this food is being produced and marketed. Michelle has published Death Metal and Music Criticism, Analysis at the Limits. Also, FATS, A Global History, and a forthcoming book, Media and Food Industries, The New Politics of Food. So, Michelle's in charge of anarchy tonight. We need a good dose of anarchy to provoke good discussion. Professor Laurie Bonney is a researcher of value chain innovation at the University of Tasmania. Laurie views innovation and creativity in value chains as mysterious processes, a lot like universities, I suspect. Not responsive to purely rational economic management, he is intrigued by how successful businesses combine trust, cooperation, power and politics to create value by implementing innovations across organisational boundaries. Laurie's ultimate challenge is applying this understanding to help create innovative agri-food systems within regions and industries in Australia and developing countries. In his previous career, Laurie was the managing director of a successful strategy, foresight and value chain consultancy operating in Australia, New Zealand and Southeast Asia. And Laurie, for me, also represents a challenging component, but an important component in an academic sense about how disciplines are constructed within universities, because agriculture is one of those disciplines that sits across many disciplines within a university, and value chains just take that one step in a harder direction, I think, Laurie, in terms of connecting all the various components that are important from a value chain perspective. So I really appreciate you being here tonight. Dr. Beth Penrose, lecturer in pasta science at TIA. So, we're really excited to have Beth with us. So, Beth relocated to the UK, to Tasmania, 1 year ago for her current job as a lecturer in pasta science. She's interested in how the nutrition from pasta affects the health of animals and ultimately humans. Did we mention Beth is a big fan of ryegrass? I think there's a story that goes with that. Bear with me, I'll tell you the story. So, Beth arrived from the UK, which has ryegrass everywhere, knows everything about ryegrass, flew into Tasmania at this time of the year, where everything was brown. There wasn't much ryegrass around that she could see out of the window of the plane. So I think as the story goes, she clutched her husband's hand and said, "Rob, there is no ryegrass in Tasmania." So then, Beth and I met, and we went on a bit of a trip, and just had a bit of a quick look around Tasmania and help her understand the context of the environment that we were working within. We went up to the Elliott Dairy Farm on the Crow Coast, and Beth laid out in a bed of ryegrass and
happily rolling around and said there is ryegrass in Tasmania. But she also understood because we introduced her to one of our technical officers in the north. She understood that in that trip, the challenges of Tasmanian agriculture in terms of its diverse climate, its diverse soils. So it was a really valuable trip, I think, and we discovered that Gazza, who knows everything about everything that's not about grasses, is one of the assets on our team. So welcome, Beth. We're excited to have you here. And Beth is also known for expressing her opinion, so I think that'll be fine tonight. Just a bit more about Beth. Her work is focused on how to improve plant, livestock and human nutrition through pasture management. There's integrated GIS started with plant and animal nutrition data to provide farmers with decision-making tools that improve the sustainability of their livestock systems. The previous work involved planning for pasture environments in the event of a nuclear accident. But Beth has just the right side kind of skills for us. Associate Professor Stephen Cahoon, Director of Sense T. I note in the description, Stephen, that you're on secondment from the Australian Maritime College. Every interaction I've had with you indicates that you're pretty much embedded in Sense T. Stephen was the head of the Department of Maritime and Logistics Management. But based in within Sense T, which is part of the University of Tasmania and a partnership between the university CSIRO and the Tasmanian government. It's also funded by the Australian government. Sense T uses data sensing technologies and data analytics to help see alignments and opportunities to improve decision making and create real impact for farmers. In 2015, Stephen co-authored the book Climate Change and the Adaption and Planning for Ports. And Tia and Sense T have an excellent relationship. We've delivered some great project outcomes to date, and we're looking forward to bringing agriculture and the data networks together through our partnership with Sense T. And our moderator, Dr. Pete Leith, a senior research fellow at TERP. Pete is passionate about ensuring that public investment on research leads to societal outcomes. He's an experienced social institutional researcher and provides social science expertise to a variety of TERP projects. Pete's research and practice is geared to improving the design of projects and programs to achieve outcomes in a way that are equitable, accountable and efficient, especially in the areas of natural resource management and sustainability. He recently published the co-author book Enhancing Science Impact, Bridging Research Policy and Practice for Sustainability. Pete can and does play the role of moral conscience to a lot of the conversation that happens in terms of really value his provocation, and he doesn't ever hesitate to provoke certainly myself and other of our colleagues. Thanks, Peter, for arranging this time. So I think I can hand over to you.
You're handing over to me. I have a lapel mic. Thank you so much for the introduction, James, and for valuing the moral compass. And thank you all for coming to this event. So obviously we saw this National Agriculture Day as an opportunity not only to have a discussion but to launch this project, which is really about having a bigger discussion with a very specific purpose that James has indicated. Before we launch into the panel discussion, I want to get your input into a couple of questions which will help us frame the discussion. So I'm going to introduce this diverse and awesome project team who are going to hand out some clicker devices. Deepa Kumar in the corner here, Kathy Evans at the back, and who else have we got? Raj is also in the audience. Seeing Raj Adhikari, Claire Baker, our awesome communications person. And is Carolina here? Carolina Garcia. So it's not just me driving this project, and I thank you, James, for launching it. So agriculture is an incredibly complicated space to work in, and when we cross the value chain into food all the way to consumers, it becomes much more complex and much more nuanced and much more diverse. We thought a good way to start this discussion about where we're heading and how we're getting there might be to invite the diverse array, or a sort of fraction of the diverse array of researchers from the university, not just from TIA, but from other areas of the university, so to start this discussion off. But I sort of wanted to get some input from you guys. So we've got these click devices. Are they all around here? Has everyone got one in their hot little hand? I guess we recognise in TIA that we're working across this value chain and dealing with a variety of drivers that range from the climate to policy and politics to market changes and forces to the actual practices of farmers and how we enable them to change for the better, both in terms of their own productivity but in terms of sustainability as well. So I just wanted to get your input into a few things. So first of all, learn how to use these devices. You press the number that's associated with the category that you want to pick. Why did you come to this event? You can only pick one answer. You can override your previous answer by pressing another number if you change your mind. I can see the votes coming in. We're up to 33. Quick game's a good game with this because we want to get on to the discussion. So I'm going to give you 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And we'll find that everyone will give free drinks. To hear what other people have to say, and one person in the audience is going to make trouble. Okay. Which of the following best describes the sector that you mostly work in? So you may cross many of them, but we'd like to see who we've got in the audience today. Oh, you guys are doing so good, good. This is a harder one, I know, but... Is anyone abstaining, or shall I assume that there's 58 people in the audience today? Okay, here we go. So, interesting, we've got mostly in the tertiary sector, as we might expect, but quite a few folks from farming and food producing areas and other private sector. And finally, the hardest question. Tasmania's future in food and agriculture depends most on, so we know that it depends on everything, all sorts of things, but if you had to pick one of these things, which you do now, I want you to pick which one it is. And we're at 58 again. 59 this time. So that was just because Rob primed you to say that, wasn't it? Interesting. Does the one person who want to pick, who's picked something else entirely want to raise their voice at this point? There he is. You get plenty of chance. Okay, so I want to move on now to start having this more detailed discussion. But this, I think, sets up a variety of tensions and questions. You know, we need to be technological and innovation, we need to have skills and knowledge, and we need to do that in order to be sustainable and use our resources wisely, and Laurie's going to tell us what else we need to do in a moment. But I have to ask the other panellists a quick question first. I'd just like to point out before I do so, though, that we have bits of paper at the end of the aisles, so if anyone feels like they have a question but they don't want to ask it themselves, feel free to jot it down and someone else will ask it for you, but these questions will come along. So my first question to lead into this panel discussion is for Beth, and James suggested that Beth has come here quite recently and that her work spans this nutrition for plants to animals to humans. And I'm wondering if you're comparing and looking at the differences between what was going on in the UK when you left and what's going on here, what do you think are the key differences? And is there anything that Tasmania can learn from the practices in that area in the UK?
Thank you.
Yeah, is that? Because you don't have a lot of elders.
So I think that's a really interesting question. I think there are lots of things that Tasmania can learn from the UK, but I do think there are also lots of things that the UK can learn from Tasmania. So I want to make that very clear from the very beginning. So I think we're at a different stage here in Tasmania in terms of development of agriculture than most farmers are in the UK. That's not a good or a bad thing, I think that's just the truth. You know, there are people who I know in the UK whose family might have lived in the same place and farmed in the same place for 300 years. So that's a very different kind of setup than lots of places in Australia and lots of places in Tasmania. What I would say is that, you know, Tasmania still has a lot of its native vegetation in comparison to the UK, where a lot of that was decimated in the sort of 1600s, 1700s, if not before. And I think there's a unique opportunity for Tasmania, particularly, as well as other parts of Australia, to maintain some of those native vegetation parts a lot of its natural resources, which have been decimated in lots of parts of Western Europe. So I think that's a real opportunity. I also think that we're moving into an area where, or a time, where we're now really thinking about how much nutritious food can we produce. And that's a very different question to how much food can we produce. Now, producing quantity of food is still really, really important, obviously. You know, there's a certain number of people in the world and we need to feed them. That's a fact. But I think that we are moving from just how many calories and how much yield can I get in terms of tonnage to how much nutritious food can we produce. And I think that's a really interesting time to be in. And I think that's true for everywhere, but I think Tasmania has a particularly big part to play in that.
Thank you. So my next question, and these questions are really to set up the field that these folks come from, because they're from very diverse areas, and Stephen's got a long and, dare I say, Czech background. but for the last 3 years or so, you've been working and leading SenseT, and in that space, it's all about big data and technology and its applications, particularly in agriculture. It seems like SenseT is focused there. So I guess there's no doubt that technology is transforming the way that agriculture and food are done. But what do you see as the biggest changes and drivers? Is change really speeding up? Or, you know, what are you seeing as the big pushes in technology we need to be aware of?
I think I'll probably begin by saying that a lot of people look to technology as being perhaps the silver bullet. No, that's going to solve a lot of issues, and that's not the case. What it will be is it will be the enabler. It'll help us to rethink some of the ways we used to do things. It'll help us to gain much greater precision in what we do. It'll provide us with the evidence that we need. So there's a lot of rules of thumb that growers may use, but as some of those growers, for example, as that baby boom starts to move out into retirement, it'll be how do we capture their knowledge, and in particular their local knowledge. So how can we utilise technology to capture that? Would be one of those solutions. Technology will be the way that we will look at the problem differently. So whether we've got much better abilities to track and trace our products as they go through the supply chain, as we move towards new technologies where at the consumer end we may have printable codes on the packets, so we can have the traffic light system on there so that you can understand really how fresh that is. So rather than having sensors inside, it'll just be printed on the packet. But I think the real issue for me with the technology is how do we help people understand what the technology is, how it can actually help them, that journey will be a longer journey than the journey of the new technologies coming through.
And so you're very much talking about internet technology, sensor technology, and big data rather than the biotech revolution and things like that. What do you think they're linked to?
Yes, the focus we have in Sense T is more on that environmental sensing, and then linking that and overlaying the range of data that we may be able to gain from that, and then looking at the particular insights that we might gain. So those advanced analytical methods, the artificial intelligence, that's some of the space that we tend to work in. So I think there's part of it is there's a process aspect to it, and then there's the new types of products that may come in as part of technology. So I think it's multifaceted.
And Michelle, I'd like to give the next question to you. You come from a very different space from the humanities and study media and communication and the way that food is represented in the media and what that means. And I guess a lot of these elements of the production side are driven by the demand. What have you seen changing in the media environment? What do you think are the big changes in the future?
Yeah, I mean, representations of food have changed quite dramatically. And what it's meant is that there's been, I guess, I mean, paid promotional advertising is still important, but it's become relatively less important as kind of integrated advertising, integrated marketing, celebrity chefs, food bloggers, micro-celebrities, media influencers have all kind of got in on the act and have had considerable share of voice in terms of how food, and particularly how good food is being represented. So we're seeing, I guess, the story of food becoming increasingly important. You know, where it's come from, how it's produced, who it's produced by. People want to see the farmer. They want to see, you know, their face on the food packaging. They want to know their story. Ethical concerns have become a lot more important. And the other thing that's become quite interesting, particularly in the kind of, I guess, food branding marketing space, is that the kind of gourmet branding has actually become a whole lot more prominent, including for sort of big brand manufacturers who haven't, historically occupied that space. And I think that's reflected, I guess, a more food literate public whose tastes are kind of, sort of more, they're more adventurous, they want to try new things, and they want something that, sort of speaks to that sort of gourmet ethical sort of side of things now.
Thank you. I've left Laurie till last because in many ways Laurie spans all of these areas. But they can ask you anything. I guess part of the value chain research is looking at the way value is distributed across the chain and how it accrues and accumulates in different parts of the value chain, whether that's at the retail end or at the production end. And there's obvious tensions in there in terms of the way markets are driven and in terms of the consumer drive. But what are you seeing as the big shifts in the way value is accumulated or accrued in the value chain at the moment?
Thanks for that question, and I'll do what politicians do and answer something else.
Okay. You said it was
like
that question.
Yeah, it is, and I'll answer the name. But I love being a provocateur, and I answered 7 to that last question because I believe the drivers of change are going to be all of the above, and in particular, altogether or individually, they're not sufficient because it's people. I would answer that people are the critical factor to the future. And it's their values, attitudes, and their willingness to adapt, along with skills and knowledge, etc. So I see people being the critical factor. And I think we sometimes give lip service to them in our research projects. And I include myself in on that. So I think the challenge for TIA is to figure out how we can facilitate change because within the population we tend to treat farmers as though they were monocultural or homogeneous group. And in fact, they're not. They're probably very diverse, reflecting the range of nationalities, ethnic backgrounds, and certainly life experiences that the whole of Australia does. So they're very diverse. They're not one single group. Yet we never, or rarely ever, consider the values, attitudes and cultures of the people that we're trying to communicate with. And I think fundamentally that's where we have to go to play our role in facilitating Tasmania's future. I won't rattle on because you can talk to me later, but I think one of the biggest changes I've seen in my lifetime in agriculture is, sure, there's been a lot of technology that's changed, but I think one of the biggest changes has been the structural and economic change that's occurred in farming. When I, in the late 1960s, when I trained in agricultural science, there were still 20-acre and 50-acre dairy farms, and people with 50 cows were making a living and raising a family. Today, what is it? I mean, I'm sure someone here can tell me. 400 might be the herd average. Yeah, I see some nods. And I've done quite a bit of demographic analysis of Tasmanian agriculture, and 66, and I must admit this is not the last census but the previous one, we're going back about 7 or 8 years. 66% of Tasmanian farms don't employ anyone apart from the owner-operator. 63% have an estimated value agricultural output of less than $150,000 a year. We're talking about largely, and this is not much different to the whole of Australia. There's only about 1% different between Tasmania in any parameter with the rest of Australia. So we're dealing with a very large number of smallholders. And it's the top 15%. Productivity Commission just recently, in one of their reports on agriculture, identified the top 15%, I think, produce 56% of the output in agriculture. So there's a question for Tia as to where do we focus. The smallholders, if I could dare call them that, the smallholders are just as... They have every right to receive the services of TIA that the top 15% do. But we also have a societal obligation and a global obligation to facilitate the food security for the globe as well as for Australia. So I think that's the biggest change. I won't rattle on, I'll just say that I think the biggest change coming is in the digital and robotics area.
You'd have to excuse me because I've got a lapel mic, which means I can stand up and walk around and invite you to ask questions. So you've seen sort of the areas that most people work in except Laurie. But I will hold him to account to answer your questions, even though I let him get away with not answering mine. So there is a roving mic. Do I have any hands of people who want to ask questions to our panel today? Who's going to go first? There's two over here. You do have to wait until you get the mic, unfortunately. Dougal. If you could state your name and keep yourself concise, that'd be great.
Dougal Closed, I can't promise I'm being concise. I'll just follow up. Laurie, so how do you make that value judgment about who deserves the focus of TIA?
Thank you for asking me the hard question. I was hoping someone else might answer this. Richard, you're a global food security guy.
Surely the 80-20 principle tells you to concentrate on those that help you solve food security and produce the most food.
Yeah. Look, I think it's a policy discussion that needs to be had. And I think there's a role... Yeah, I'll be provocative again. I think there's a role for TIA and the university to provide a forum for discussing the hard questions that that people are avoiding for all sorts of reasons. And I think we could offer a neutral environment, a value-free environment as far as it's humanly possible, for that sort of a discussion to be had. Because I think it's vital to Pete's project that we understand where that balance is.
I'm glad we've already established that everyone thinks we should do this project. Would you like to...
Well, I'd also like to add that in my limited experience, has to be said, of being in Tasmania, we started to do some work to understand the proportion of farmers who are producing a certain amount of produce. So is the 80-20 rule where 20% of the farmers are producing 80% of the product, is that true for all industries? Our data, which we haven't fully analysed yet, suggests that that isn't true for every single product. So I think you have to be quite careful when you talk about statistics in general, that each product might have a different demographic. And so, for example, we're doing some work on beef at the moment, which suggests that actually that isn't quite the case. And that actually something like 40% of farmers, beef farmers in Tasmania, produce about 80% of the beef. And that changes the way in which you look at engagement or the way in which you look at research or development in quite a lot. And I think we have to be careful when we make sweeping statements about things.
They're not sweeping statements, it's obvious steps.
Yeah, sure, no.
But I think what you're saying is what Stephen is saying.
Sorry,
we have to have evidence.
I should have mentioned earlier, folks, and sorry to the, our first question was that this has been recorded, so that's why we need to use the microphone. So if you, that was part of the reason why we had different paper.
I was quoting from ABS analysis, or was my analysis of ABS stats. But I think we need to turn to a comment that Stephen made before about the aggregation of data silos will give us the evidence to make better decisions.
Well, what we find in Sense T when we do our different projects is that there's a lot of urban myths. There's a lot of, and just to give you an example of some cold chain management work that we did, where people were saying if a refrigerated truck turns up with the stores closed and it's been running, and you throw in some cold or cool products into that, everything will be right until it gets to its destination. Well, that's not true. But I was speaking to people in the freight industry, and they said, look, that's the way it should work. After we put about 80 sensors throughout, we had a Ford engineer working with us, then there's a whole range of other factors that start to come into it. But that's just one little example about the urban myths. And I think that's what we really have to start looking at. What is real and what is something that's been embellished over time? The data will be one means of helping us to achieve that. And that's whether it's a small farmer or a large-scale farmer.
Thank you. Richard, do you have a question?
Yeah, I did have a question, and it was about what Laurie introduced, food security. And I was just wondering what role you think Tasmania might play or might have in the area of food security. Does it have any role at all? And if it does, what leadership role might we have?
So can I just clarify if you're talking about the food security of the state or the nation or the globe?
I mean global food security. If you look at New Zealand, for example, most agricultural products are 95% or more exported. So yeah, it's a huge amount of food going offshore.
So, Laurie, give us the point. I'm going to ask Michelle to respond to that a little bit too, if you can, because it's an interesting point about where we're going.
I'll be very quick because I've had a bit to say. But Australia in total produces approximately 1% of the world's food. Tasmania, from memory, is roughly 7% of Australia. I think Australia and Tasmania both have a niche opportunity. Now, sure, I'm reminded quite often at meetings that not everybody can be a niche producer, but some people have to produce commodities. And not everybody wants to be a niche producer because it's a particular set of skills and a particular amount of effort that's required. However, I think our future lies in finding niches that are not necessarily small, because they could be global niches that in terms of volume and economic value are huge, but in global terms they are niches.
So the reason I wanted to extend this to Intel is that part of this is working across value chains. Part of it is also the branding of Tasmania, which is so important, and to the value of the product and the way that's marketed at global scale. So we're not talking, as Holger often says, we're not talking about the food bottle of the world, we're talking about the PowerPoint. So.
From the standpoint I come from, I'm slightly perplexed by the discussions around food security because, you know, at the moment we're kind of in a place where the kind of current frontier around food politics is around food waste. You know, so I was, you know, this kind of thing that we need to produce more food, maybe we need to think more carefully about the food we already produce and how that's distributed and how that gets accessed. The focus on export markets. Tasmania has an incredibly powerful and coherent brand that is very persuasive outside the island. And I think what is interesting about the Tasmanian brand is that it seems to sit well across operational scale. So for both kind of boutique food, but also for larger scale operators, that sort of Tasmania brand as a very powerful, authentic, safe, clean, that seems to work. And I think that there's not many places where that actually happens.
Can you respond to that?
Just very quickly.
Could I just see if there's any hands for the microphone for the next question in the audience? So I can get to you.
It's not a contrary comment to what's just been made. But I'll quote, almost, paraphrase perhaps, the business development director for Simplot and their general manager Asia. And they said, clean and green is a license to be in the game.
So it's a condition of entry rather than...
It's not a competitive edge, it's a license to be in the game.
Stephen's going to take that one. You
want to
follow
that? The comment about wastage is so important. Now, we've put a lot of effort into the right sort of growing conditions and how we raise these crops, for example. But worldwide, there's something like $750 billion a year of wastage through the cold chain and food handling. So you think about why isn't more effort being put into that? It's just incredible to see a full truckload of lettuce products being thrown out because the temperatures haven't been maintained properly is such a terrible waste of resource. And what sort of impact does that end up having on the company's bottom line? So we should start to turn around some of the focus. So, yeah, completely agree with that one.
Thank you.
Ian Mock. My question gets back to these aspirations. Given that statistics are something like 76% of Tasmania's food production goes offshore, will that mean that your aspirations will focus on that outcome that the food is not actually consumed here but sold interstate and overseas?
So this is a question to me about
well, it's a general question. These aspirations, which is fantastic, but where does the end market sit in those aspirations?
So I guess the project itself is really about the aspirations of Tasmanian food producers and growers. And in terms of that question, it's where they are seeing the market opportunities and advantages. So a lot of the innovation that's occurring is where people see a new opportunity in a market sense. So that's sort of what we're trying to do is understand how people are capitalising on those opportunities. But do other people want to respond to question?
I think the major issue for me about the international markets, I think what we're trying to do is identify where the most lucrative markets are, and because of the types of products that often we have in Tasmania with the premium and high quality, if we have identified the right sort of markets who want to pay the right sort of price, then how can we ensure that those products get them in the highest quality possible. So it's how we can trace that product right the way through to ensure it gets to the market in the right sort of state. Because markets can be quite fickle. If we end up putting down something that ends up arriving low quality through no fault of our own back at this early stage of the supply chain, then that market could end up being lost very, very quickly.
Does that address your question?
I just think it's important that we've been talking for an hour now and we've been very well focused on where our product actually goes. I don't think the word export's been mentioned once so far. Very often in all the prelude and the initial discussions, I just think that's where our future is. Everything we produce is not going to be eaten in Tasmania or necessarily Australia.
I thoroughly agree with you, Ian. I think some of my comments I was alluding to without specifically suggesting that people should export, because I don't think you can make people export. Exporting is far harder than just supplying domestic markets. You really do have to have your supply chain management in order. You have to have your cold chains in order before you start crossing national boundaries and dealing with the problems of the inadequate institutional and industry systems that might exist in other countries. I mean, we're working, some of our research is in China with seafood, and we're not even allowed to talk to consumers or the restaurants that, use Southern Rock Lobster. So it's very, so, you know, the issues of institutional and industry systems is a massive challenge for anyone wanting to export, and I'm not saying they're going to be as bad as that. But so we have to get our supply chain management right in our current chains and then start thinking about working together to export.
So I took what you were saying earlier about people as partly an answer to this export question as well, that it's actually the skills and the resources, but also the relationships that are needed to manage that. I will let you speak for every question.
Yeah, I just say people need to work together. And the challenge is to be able to get the volume of and the standard. These are the three fundamental supply chain problems. Is consistent volume, consistent quality, at a consistent price. Doesn't matter where you're sending it to.
Larry, Jan.
Try to find a simple way to couch this question, probably because I'm an economist and not in agriculture. I'd be really interested to hear some comments about things that have been alluded to, for example, the dairy farms changing from being 50 cows to being far more corporate. You've got your Simplots and your McCains and your enlarged producers, and they curtail what those individual producers can do in managing their crops, although it gives the benefit of not having to deal with sales and that whole end. But I'd be interested in some of your comments about the changing economics of both the purchases and supply of the food that's produced, but also the individual farmers and whether their choices and the economics of their individual farms are curtailing and potentially not as good as they have been and where that's going, or whether the future is looking better because of these larger corporates, if that makes sense.
Stephen?
Perhaps I could try to answer that with the word collaboration. What we don't do very well here is collaborate. So in terms of being able to get better prices for products that we may need to buy and also for the products we then sell, we look over the hill and we see them those other farmers as being our competitors. We're not competing against them at all. We've got the international markets or other national markets. I remember speaking to some honey growers and asking them about their bottling. If the honey farm over the hill, if they collaborate with them to gain those economies of scale when they're making the orders, they said, oh, no, we don't do that. Even though they can make a choice of, you have the round bottles, we'll have the rectangular bottles. But I think that collaboration, not understanding co-opetition, where at different times they may be competing on some factors, but there are other factors they can actually collaborate on. So I think, yes, we get some of the larger operators coming in, but that also doesn't stop some of the smaller operators from coming together on certain for certain business activities and competing on others.
I think it's also worth saying that just because the farms have got bigger doesn't necessarily mean that they're corporate. Lots of family farms are also a great deal larger than they were, you know, 30, 40, 50 years ago, and that they still might be run by, you know, one or two people. So I think absolutely there are some very large farms which are owned by, you know, large corporations. But there are also some pretty large farms that are owned by family businesses. I think that's worth keeping in mind.
You're also alluding to that they're supplying a large corporation, particular family farms that are sort of put within a particular supply chain.
Sorry, I've lost my microphone.
That's all right.
But it limits innovation and the capacity for those farmers to do what they might think is best if they're supplying to a larger farms or Simplot who require them to do things in a particular way to buy the produce.
Yeah, so they're often actually told what to do in many aspects of their operation. So,
Michelle, do you want to talk about this? You've got a microphone now.
I'm just holding the microphone.
I've got a question at the back.
David Moncton, if your question is around global security, looking at this from the point of view of an economist, wouldn't you really be more, shouldn't UTAS really be looking at this from the perspective of global production and where we can contribute the most? So regardless of Tasmania, we don't actually care where it's produced. It's more about how it will be produced and how efficiently it will be produced.
So you're talking about food in general.
Food in general, and how we as an organisation should engage with that question of delivering the outcome we seek.
Does anyone want to have a crack at that? It's a little bit closer to Richard's question, but we'll build on it if you can.
How do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. And if we apply that principle to Tasmania and TIA, I think we have to say that we need to get our own act into order, and that is we have a tenfold challenge to get the agricultural output to $10 billion by 2050. If we were able to do that, I think we'd make a big contribution to global food security. I think we need to focus on the bite of the elephant that we can chew. And that means that we have to identify markets, whether they're in Australia or around the world, optimise our imaging and branding. I'm a believer in Tasmania's image versus a company brand. I think companies need to invest and nurture and love their brands. I don't see Brand Tasmania down the road, a public service agency, investing, loving and nurturing the brand of Tasmania. I see individual farmers and individual companies doing that.
So there seems to be an interesting tension always between the question of quality and local sort of produce, or not even local produce, but the produce to premium markets, or in some way differentiated markets, and the sort of questions around global food security, which are often about bulk commodity exports, and I often hear these discussions in Tasmania as either or questions, but they really seem to be both and answers. You know, often it's a mix, right? And anyway, that's my two bob. Neville, you've got a microphone. Sorry.
Okay, Alice Percy. This question is probably for Michelle more than anybody else. Just wondering how important
agritourism experiences are for sales domestically and globally, so people coming here, experiencing something on farm, and then purchasing elsewhere.
Yeah, that's a good question. I've never seen any stats around that kind of thing, but I do know that what the international research shows us is that agritourism really has an impact in terms of creating particular kinds of feelings and associations and brands around particular places. So the agritourism movement in Italy, for example, is, it's incredibly powerful for creating particular kinds of associations between sort of authentic Italian food and certain types of food products. I imagine in the Australian context it would be a useful part of the mix. And here we can probably do that more successfully in other places because, I mean, one of the challenges that we have is the vast distances that people are travelling for these different agritourism experiences, which makes them less appealing. I think some really well-crafted, sort of thoughtful, integrated kinds of experiences could be really effective.
So I hear that agricultural and food tourism is the fastest growing sector of the tourism industry from a low base. Neville?
Just to comment on this global food security, surely the UTOS's and TO's main contribution would be in having well-trained people, either postgrads or staff that go out and do things in the world, as people like Laurie have done in value chain work in Vietnam or Indonesia or wherever. If we've got good people that are well established here and helping to produce Tasmanian sort of food, but they can also go out and in many developing countries and do the same sort of thing, train people there to look after their own problems and produce their own food, must be the best thing we can do.
I'll take that as a comment. Thank you, Neville. But I would also add that TIA is becoming a research institute within the College of, what's it called? Science? And engineering. and as such, we'll have a broader mandate than it does at the moment in terms of working internationally and in different areas. And it is a key. So this week we're signing at MAU in university with the Chinese Association for Agricultural Science, which is an organisation of 10,000 members. You know, it is a key aspect that people are interested in our capacity and our IP. Thank you.
Yeah, my question is also for Michelle. Coming from the Netherlands and like to kind of compare what is going on there and here, I see one big difference is in that the willingness to pay for local products and experiences. So today I was talking to a guy and he was selling a bottle of whiskey for $270. I pick strawberries for $15 a kilo. It's all, it's normal. Not normal, but people are apparently much more willing to pay for high quality local products than in the Netherlands, and I also think that it's the same for Italy. So is that a thing that is only going on in Tasmania, or is that an Australian thing, and where do you think this will go?
I mean, certainly the kind of, that sort of boutique high-end thing that we're seeing happening, particularly around provenance, local food, real food, that really is a kind of middle class phenomenon that really does require, economic capital to buy into that. I think it is a really interesting comparison with the Netherlands. I was quite struck with that when I was there, with that difference in that food is really cheap and that provenance is relative or quite a lot less important. Which I did find sort of quite surprising because I think there's been quite a strong movement here in Australia, in the US and the UK around provenance as being important. And I think certainly in those places it's going to continue to be so. I'm not sure why in parts of Europe it's not, but it is quite different.
To make a comment as a British person, and having come rather recently from Britain, I would say that strangely, when I was very, very shocked, I guess, how much people were willing to pay for local here, and how much local there was available, because obviously Tasmania is able to produce so many different types of food, which is great, and the fact that people want Tasmanian food, Tasmanians, I think, in general, want Tasmanian food, that's really, really different. And I think my personal experience of British people is that there are some things that they want to buy British. So, for example, a lot of people want to buy British meat. That's partly because we have relatively high welfare standards in comparison to a lot of other countries where we might be importing meat from. And also because there's something about freshness about meat that people associate local with being fresh. And that's very important now. Whether it's any fresher than meat from continental Europe, I couldn't tell you, but people associate it with that, certainly. But I would say that there are only really a few products which British people will really pay a premium for local. Otherwise, they're not bothered. In my experience, is that they want to pay the least amount possible, or they want to get exactly the product they want. And those are two different things. I would say that they're much more like the Netherlands than perhaps we might think.
Thank you. Hello, my name's Daryl. I'm not from the agriculture sector. So really quite interesting, for me, an interesting question is I hear a lot about where the top end of the sector is. Where is the bottom end and why is it there? Where do we go from being a food producer to being a farmer? And with the trends that we might be seeing in the world, like quite socially orientated trends, where's your interest in that space? My backyard is basically, is my backyard part of the system?
I hope I'm getting the gist of your question right. I'll give a quick answer, I think. As I said before, there's a normal distribution curve of just about everything from attitudes and the aspirations and capability of producers. The top end, clearly, we've been referring to as niche products and, you know, contributing up more than their fair share of the output, agricultural output. But the bottom end, and that's quite large, I'm hopefully in the near future, maybe with they're going to do some demographic analysis of the tail, if I could call it that, the long tail. And all of those are lifestyle producers, or even though they work full-time, there's a very large percentage of farmers or farms and farm families where some members of the farm family work off the farm to sustain the family income. You know, they run a contracting business. The wife is a nurse and the husband does a bit of shearing or whatever, but he still thinks of himself as being a full-time farmer. And you'd be surprised how big those farms are. And the percentage could be, in my view, could be as high as 70% of farms are like that in some industries or some sectors. So I think it's going to be some analysis, and I'd say this project will do that. And I think it will be very illuminating on to answer the sort of question I think that you're alluding to.
Sure, Stephen.
Could you give that,
I think one of the other parts of the question here is, are we using our land in the best possible manner? So how optimised is our practices? So if we had some data which was indicating to farmers or potential farmers, look, here is the best crop for the next 5 years or 10 years, given the environmental conditions, given the risks that may be prevalent, and also given some of the market demands and other economic factors, would that be enough to change someone's view in what sort of crops they would put in place? So there may be some more lifestyle related farmers who may say, no, I grow potatoes, I've always grown potatoes, and that's what we'll do. But is there an opportunity there for us to start to change some of our thinking and have that data in place? and some steps have already been made towards that. So if you go on to TPWI's website and have a look at their enterprise suitability mapping, and if you can enter in a whole range of different parameters on there, but if you want to grow barley in Tasmania, you can enter that in and it'll show you all the different places that's best for barley. But I think where we're getting to is the use of data and overlaying a whole range of different types of data and then using the right sort of algorithms is we can start to forecast that. And in fact, that's some of the work that we've already started working on and to see, can we actually do that? Can we capture all those different forms of data and use it in a useful way to help to agriculturally optimise Tasmania?
I'm only going to take a couple more questions because we have to go and have drinks after this. So I'll let Laurie respond
One sentence. I'll say we cannot ignore freedom of choice of people who own land. They will have different motivations and different aspirations and different capabilities, and we cannot ignore that.
Or override it.
Yes, look, I run a farm with apples, cherries and cattle, so we're doing our pasture management at the moment, we're doing a lot of silage, but and with cattle we deal with a lot of genetics as well to get the best product at the end of the day. However, for my apple markets and my cherry markets, and we're talking about bottom end prices I'm gathering and niche high prices and tagging into those markets, at the end of the day, for the grower and the farmer, it is supply and demand in the markets. We cannot dictate our prices to the markets. They dictate it to us. And if the supply is in need, if they're demanding it and they need your product, which is where we're at the moment with apples, you get a good price. Now, I've kept my apples for the last 9 months, and the quality is still good, but 9 months ago when I picked them, the quality was probably better, and I got less for my product back then because the market was flooded. It's the same with cherries. You know, you get your product in early. If the market in China gets flooded,
Do you have a question?
No, I'm just, that's just my comment.
I'm just going to take one more question because I'm standing between you all and drinks and you're looking thirsty.
Can I make a comment whilst we're waiting?
Whilst you're waiting.
I think it's great to have some maps, for example, of where you can grow different things. But I do think that it's the role of TIA and the role of the university to understand how that's going to impact Tasmania as an environment, as well as individual people or people's livelihoods.
Yes. Hello, my name's Rajan. I wanted to ask a question about nutrition. I don't think we've spoken much about that today. When I look around the community at people's shopping trolleys and what they're eating in food courts, it's processed foods, it's highly packaged foods, it's imported foods, it's frozen foods, it's foods coming from large corporations. There are a lot of people, you know, I hear what you're saying about the interest in provenance, where food is coming from, $270 bottles of whiskey and all of that, but for a large segment of the population, those, you know, the nutrition is coming from those other sources. What does your research or your vision for the future of Tasmania have to contribute to the nutrition of that vast majority of the population?
So I'm going to let Beth field this one first and then Michelle.
Yeah, so I think that's a really interesting question. Actually, we're doing some research with some of our nutrition colleagues in Launceston on how much Tasmanian food Tasmanians eat. So hopefully you can get involved in that. That's going to come out very soon. I think that there's definitely a shift, I would say, and probably know more about it than I do, but from eating a lot of processed food. I think, yes, I'm middle class, let's be honest. I'm an academic, and I think that may be a middle class thing, but in the UK particularly, I think it is actually moving from the middle class to being also a working class thing, to want to cook your own food, to want to use whole, you know...
And to think about nutrition.
And to think about nutrition. I think that's definitely something that, people are looking at. It's something that the Food and Agriculture Organization of the UN is now looking at. It's been a big shift in the last maybe 2 to 3 years from having enough food to having the right nutrition. And I think it's something we're going to see regardless. But I do think we have a part to play in that.
Michelle, would you like to say a few words and wrap up?
So I'm not sure I can answer the Tasmanian dimension to that question, but if I was, I guess, to diagnose what I think is, I think that the public health messages that have been kind of circulated over the last several decades have a significant part to play in this, because the focus of a lot of these messages for a long time has been around particular kind of nutrients. We should eat less fat, or, you know, it's focused on these kind of nutritional components of food rather than thinking about food as whole foods. And this has provided, you know, excellent opportunities for the processed food industry to kind of fill that gap. Okay, so fat's a problem, therefore what we just need to do is produce processed foods with less fat, and that solves the problem. So it's provided these kind of excellent sort of marketing opportunities for the food industry, while not actually tackling the baseline problem. So I think there's been this sort of quite problematic relationship between, I guess, the public health industry and the food industry that has kind of reinforced this problem. That's my idea.
We have to wrap as we enter the world of food politics. I'm just going to get you to pick up your clippers, finally. Sorry? I take away. So you can't, only one of you has been left. So you can. You will be identified. Yeah. Have you had a good time? If not, there's a complaints box outside. No, any suggestions if you have them in relation to any of the things we've been discussing in your aspirations program, would be pleased to hear here. Otherwise, I won't stand between you and the drinks. I think James is going to wrap us up.
Okay. So my run sheet says that I need to offer some key messages from this conversation. I'm entirely sure how to do that, so I'm going to offer some reactions. My first reaction is, Pete, what have we started, and how do we finish it? But my second reaction is, I'm delighted to see the diversity in the audience this evening, and I think it's that diversity and passion and capability that sits in this audience tonight that will actually deliver some of the answers that we're looking for. From Mella to Beth, to leaders of industry like Nicola, to Pastor Steve coming to represent, it's good to, see you here. As well as growers, so it's fantastic. Thank you to our panelists. Oh, a couple more observations. So, our anarchist delivered, so thank you for that, Michelle. Your key question, I think, is less but better managed food a strong one that you've been delivering more? We nearly had an academic argument, but I saw some restraint. So that was good to see. But I was also very pleased to see some forthright and passionate questions, but also positions that were taken tonight. And that's the sort of data and information we need through this process. So thank you to Michelle Philpott, Associate Professor Laurie Bonnie, Beth Penrose, Associate Professor Stephen Gooden, and moderator Ed Leek for an excellent discussion, including a very diverse discussion. Clearly, this conversation's only just started, and we'll be in touch, and there'll be opportunities for you to be in touch with us as we touch base with the industry and government and the rural community about where Tasmania's agriculture and food sector is heading and how we'll get there. We also invite you to join in and let the project team know that you're keen to be involved, if you are, either by offering your thoughts or by helping us reach your community networks as well, which is another key part of getting to those sometimes unheard voices. Clearly the conversation can only be enhanced now by a glass of beer or wine, and we invite you to join us for that. just want to acknowledge a couple of quick things as we wrap up. So firstly, thanks to Claire Barker and Natasha Andrews for back there. Excellent effort tonight, and thank you for pulling us together. It's always highly stressful, but they always deliver. And I just want to acknowledge Hazel McTavish-West, a member of our advisory board. We have these debates and discussions at the advisory board table, and we're really pleased to see you here tonight. So thanks for taking the time. And thank you, everybody, for attending.